Hola, dear listeners. My name is Kishore Ganesh, and in the 8th episode of the Vocal About Visuals podcast, I will be analyzing the 4th movie of the Conan franchise, Captured in Her Eyes. Surprise! I know. I said I was doing a 3-part mini event, but then I was in a flow, and I would have eventually gotten to this anyway. So I figured, before I get to my most favorite Conan movie of all time, in the episode that will be out next week, right on time for the release of Detective Conan Movie 24, The Scarlet Bullet, I thought I will put my analysis of Captured in Her Eyes on a podcast. For your listening pleasure, well, you guys be the judge of that. And without any further ado, let's get straight into the pod. First things first, this movie essentially revolves around Ran. So if you are a person who is extremely pissed at the way Ran is written in this franchise and have heard other episodes of my podcast, you could expect there to be a lot of ranting from me. Get it? Ranting? Anyway, coming back to the podcast, you could expect there to be a lot of ranting from me in this episode about the issues with Ran's characterization, which can only be laid more bare in a movie that revolves around her. But what came as a surprise to me, and also maybe to the folks I've mentioned, is that there are quite a few sequences in this film through which the writers finally find redemption for the sins they have committed against Ran. Okay, I'm exaggerating a bit here with the sins and the redemption part, but what I'm actually trying to say is that despite the continuation of the damsel in distress trope, Ran has a few sequences in the film where she earns this trope. It's not the convenient, oh, what is a woman who is a protagonist's lover going to be? I know, the damsel in distress situation here. In the film, Ran is very much a part of the main narrative, where owing to her being in the wrong place at the wrong time, she ends up becoming one of the victims of the villain. And for the first time since the climax of the first movie, you end up feeling sorry for her, because the circumstances are more fleshed out. Coming to what specifically happens to Ran, and this is not a spoiler by the way, she happens to witness Detective Sato get shot by the villain, and that trauma makes her develop amnesia. Even though she is amnesiac, the villain doesn't want to take any chances, and hence her life is in peril, and it falls on Conan, her family, the detective boys, and the police to keep her safe. It is in this state of amnesia where you actually feel sorry for Ran. Ran, so far, has been showcased as an extremely one-dimensional character whose only job is to pine for Shinichi. But here, she has no memories of who she is or who anyone else is for that matter. So in a way, the one convenient loop that the writers wrote Ran into, where she pines for Shinichi, may or may not fight off bad guys in the climax, rather unsuccessfully at that, and eventually gets saved by Shinichi, is in fact removed by the writers themselves. And we get to see Ran live, breathe, and operate for Ran herself. Mind you, it's not that she does anything different in this movie compared to other movies, but at least in this, the tragedy is Ran's and Ran's alone. And even more importantly, the tragedy is not being able to be with Shinichi. In a way, I was rather proud of Ran in this movie, and of the writers as well. But as I mentioned, it is in fact Ran's movie. So it makes sense that I talk about her best friend Sonoko as well. I think in most movies, we get an understanding of how devoted a friend Sonoko is to Ran. But in this movie, their friendship truly shines. When Ran is in the hospital, it is Sonoko who is by her side taking care of her, and she makes her a promise that even if she does not remember her, she will still be her friend. This scene is a good showcase of the depth of their friendship and also worked big time for me. What can I say? I'm a sucker for beautiful friendships that are high on loyalty. Speaking of friendships, we find the detective boys also showing how much they care for Ran by volunteering to not just help her remember things, but to protect her as well. All very adorable. But the reason why I mentioned the sequence is not just because it is adorable. I mentioned it because it is in the same sequence that Haibara also happens to reveal something to Conan, which is simultaneously adorable and heartbreakingly sad. This small scene illuminates the tragedy that is at the heart of Haibara's character in an extremely beautiful way. In a way, this scene is what Haibara is all about. Coming to the other characters in the movie, the main man, boy, Conan, has several action scenes. Instead of beating around the bush, the writers have just straight up made Ran the focus of the movie. So for the majority of the time, Conan hangs around her and protects her. And this is amplified big time in the climax. None of this is a complaint though, from my end, because the movie substantiates the reasons behind this appropriately. The other characters range from good to average. No one does anything that is particularly remarkable or memorable. They do their jobs and keep the story moving forward. Finally, coming to the villain, I should say he's actually quite villainous. He is ruthless, conniving, and remains hidden till the very end of the film. That said, his motive for committing the crimes, well, that was rather weak and uninspiring. On the whole, as effective as the villain was, his motive could and should have been more convincing. As mentioned at the end of the last segment, the villain lacking a convincing motive, along with other issues like none of the characters having an impactful outing, renders this movie to be average in my opinion. There just aren't enough highlights in the movie to break the monotony of the narration. In fact, the biggest highlight I can think of from this movie was the Hybera Conan interaction that I mentioned previously. And that's more of a series highlight in the sense that it is not limited to just the narrative of this film. On the whole, this movie develops at a slow and leisurely pace, but there are not enough moments to arrest the interest of the audience over the course of its runtime. I'm not saying it is unwatchable or boring or anything close to that, but for a plot that is about saving a heroine who has seen the perpetrator commit a crime, post which she gets afflicted by amnesia, the final product on screen is a bit underwhelming. So what we have here is a movie that makes a gentle and polite request to the audience to watch it instead of one that pins you down and doesn't let go. Captured in a Rise is a film whose plot held a lot of promise, but one that is also sadly let down by the execution. To the fans of Conan, well, you will anyway end up watching this film, so I don't need to convince you guys. And to the casual anime mystery film watcher, I would say, don't expect too much from it, and you will be able to appreciate the sensitive human sides of Ran and a whole bunch of other characters, in addition to getting the feeling of having watched a strictly middle-of-the-road mystery anime movie. Once again, my name is Kishore Ganesh, this is the Vocal About Visuals podcast, and thank you, dear listeners, for your time and for listening.